It's great to be part of a credit union that professes our Catholic faith.
Oceanside Christopher is a Catholic credit union, and they care about the Catholic community on Long Island.
It's a community. You come here, you feel like you know everybody in here, you feel comfortable, and always get great service.
You don't get that feeling when you go somewhere else to a commercial bank or even another credit union for that matter.
You come in here, everybody knows your name. It's always a hassle-free environment, and it's very enjoyable to do business here.
We love that we're always greeted by a smile. Everybody here is so nice. We love the hours, the local feel of it. It's just like being a part of home when we come here.
I love this place. It's because it's a natural place. I do my finances, but I also get to know my faith is being represented.
And when I use my Oceanside Christopher Visa card, a portion of my purchase goes to support Catholic parishes. Hello and welcome to Everyday Faith Live. I'm Monsignor Jim Vlorn, joined by Sister Mary Alice Peel. In world news, almost 600,000 refugees and migrants have made their way across the Mediterranean to Europe this year, and the majority of those who have landed on the Greek islands closest to Turkey.
Migration experts say the numbers arriving on the islands have surged recently to as many as 7,000 a day, trying to reach Europe before the weather worsens. The biggest numbers arriving in Greece are from Syria, Afghanistan, Iraq, and Pakistan.
The Greek island of Lesbos, they say, is just packed right now with people who are just piling in. It's unbelievable. It's so sad.
One forgets that the weather will be a factor here for them. And mm-hmm. So if they don't make it now, they'll suffer even more over the winter.
And the news is not carrying this anymore.
Not at that? All. Yeah. And we have to keep the pressure on, because these are our brothers and sisters who are being really systematically removed from their homelands.
Yeah, it's incredible what's going on. Millions of Christians are at risk amid rise in persecution across the globe right now. And according to Aid to the Church in Need, Christians are fast disappearing from the entire region, most notably the Middle East, but also whole dioceses in Africa. In large part, this migration is the product of an ethnic cleansing motivated by religious hatred.
Joining us today is Ed Clancy, Director of Evangelization and Outreach, Aid to the Church in Need. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Well, it's so good to have you, because I think you can give us a perspective on what's going on over there.
Well, I can try. It's a little bit overwhelming when you start looking at what is actually happening. As you mentioned, the lead-in, places in Africa, the Middle East, and even in Asia are suffering persecution like never before. Two studies recently say that 75 to 80% of all persecution in the world is done to Christians. So it's a very, very tough problem right now. And you're quite right that with winter coming, it'll be very difficult for many of these people who left with nothing more than their shirts on their backs mm-hmm. to survive, let alone to set roots or to have any sort of real life.
Ed, do you have any sense that the Holy Father's, you know, upcoming visit to Africa will have any effect, at least in these African dioceses where we're seeing so much of this pain and suffering?
Well, I will hope that the Holy Father's visit would bring some attention to it. I think, you know, I was listening to you before coming on. You're talking about the news doesn't cover it. It seems that the news is very selective in how they cover and what they cover in the news. And if the Holy Father were to say something about Christian persecution, it might not get covered. And I think that's our responsibility at the parish level, at the church level, and at the local level to start to spread the news. So Africa really is in a very precarious situation. Parts of Nigeria, Chad, and Cameroon, and many other countries, Central African Republic, are in danger of having, as you said, whole dioceses wiped out, parishes disappeared. Mm-hmm. Because of the forces.
Ed, tell us how you would work with this situation. What do you do to get aid to these people? And then how can we help that?
Well, we follow the principle of subsidiarity, in that the local dioceses are very well capable of understanding the needs of their people. Mm-hmm. An example would be back when there was a tsunami, earlier about a decade ago, Red Cross took weeks to get set up. Meanwhile, the church had funds available within hours. And the same thing was true in Haiti. And the same thing is true now in the Middle East and Africa. So last year when Archbishop Kaigama came, he was talking about the immediate aid that the church provides at the local level and how keen the local priests and nuns are to understand what is needed. It's easy. It's very easy for us once we have the money to give it to them and them to put it into good use.
I know also, Ed, you were gracious enough to bring the Archbishop of Aleppo here not long ago. He went home to a disaster in his own diocese, right?
Yeah, it was actually unfolding as he was here. Every day as I was driving with him, we'd get new reports of something else happening. You know, the Patriot Cave being bombed and the Armenian church, which was bombed on the anniversary, the 100th anniversary of the Armenian genocide. And each day, him facing those challenges, you could see it on his face as he was hearing the news reported to him over the phone. It's quite dire. It's really to say that an area of the world where Christianity was born might be wiped clean of any Christian presence is very unsettling. And I think it doesn't hold well for the future of that area.
Can you give us...
Sorry, go ahead.
Sorry, I was just asking if you could give us your website so people can go and learn more about this.
Sure. It is www.churchneed.org. And next week or in a week and a half, we will be releasing Persecuted and Forgotten, which is a report on many of these topics. And in the future, we also hope to send some care packages for the winter. And you can check on our website for more information on that.
Terrific. Ed, thanks so much for being with us. Please keep us informed, okay? You're doing a great job.
Thank you. And thank you for having me. God bless you.
God bless you, too. Thank you. In Vatican News, the Synod on the Family in Rome has focused on the challenges modern-day families face and how the gospel and the church can provide support. In the following days, groups within the Synod will start looking at concrete solutions and share them for consideration.
Numerous bishops voiced concern over the lack of a clear definition of marriage in the Synod's controversial guiding text, promoting a call for one based on scripture and church teaching to be added.
During the Synod, smaller groups are formed, and one group, Group D, of the four English-speaking circles, wrote in their report that the Instrumentum Laboris nowhere defines marriage. The group wrote, "This lack of definition causes ambiguity throughout the text, suggesting a paragraph from the 1965 Second Vatican Council document, Gaudium et Spes, as a correction." So that's important because I think a definition of marriage is sort of basic to this whole discussion, right?
That's true. And of course, the Second Vatican Council spent a great deal of time on that. Why recreate something when we all know that Gaudium et Spes has been the guiding principle for us these past, believe it, 50 years.
Sure.
So I can see where they would want to go back there and take a look at that. But certainly a definition needs to appear somewhere in the text.
It's amazing to watch the cardinals, archbishops working together and struggling through the conversation sometimes so that they can kind of come to consensus. And we're actually getting to peek in at something that I don't know that we ever were able to do this before since the advent of the internet and communications like this. We're actually in, you know, with them in some on some level, like in discussing and going to their blogs. You can see what they're discussing. It's amazing.
It's amazing, but it could also be dangerous in that they wouldn't say as much publicly as they may wish to say for fear that it would be sent out. So there is some value to going behind closed doors and fighting it out and then putting it out for the public.
Sure. But again, I welcome that the idea of that open dialogue. It's just been very interesting to watch. And again, praying to the Holy Spirit for guidance all along the way, which is a lot different than like a national convention for a presidential candidate. There's something about the spirituality of this that's very reassuring. The results of several days of small group meetings at the Synod of Bishops on the Family point to a need to change the way the church communicates with the world and come to a new understanding of what marriage and family looks like in the modern world.
Philadelphia's Archbishop Charles Chaput addressed the Synod Assembly, calling for precise language, especially when speaking about inclusion and unity in diversity. He said, "Brothers, we need to be very cautious in devolving important disciplinary and doctrinal issues to national and regional episcopal conferences, especially when pressure in that direction is accompanied by an implicit spirit of self-assertion and resistance.
When discussing those who feel excluded from modern society and even the church, Cardinal Timothy Dolan from the Archdiocese of New York said, "I'm thinking of those who, relying on God's grace and mercy, strive for virtue and fidelity." He continued, "This includes couples who choose not to cohabitate before marriage, spouses who endure hardships in marriage, gay men or women who embrace chastity, a mother who sacrifices her career for her children, and spouses who lovingly welcome children into their marriage."
Cardinal Dolan concluded, "They are looking to the church, to us, for support and encouragement, a warm sense of inclusion. We cannot let them down."
And once again, a peek into the discussion, which is such an important thing, that, you know, Archbishop Chaput talking about that idea that we need to convey the magisterium, the teaching, and also the true sense and the heart of the synod to the conferences that will ultimately communicate to you and I.
That's right. But, of course, the issue is that the conferences are all at different stages of development in terms of some of these issues. You know, the way in which the church in Africa operates because of the various cultural aspects that we find in Africa versus what happens here in the United States, these are pastoral responses to those issues. Sure. And I think that's what the Cardinal is emphasizing.
You know? And the document that's going to come out will truly be a text for the entire world. And that's another component of this, that we're so used to seeing the bishops give us a document that's sort of American, you know. This is a global document. It's going to be an interesting document for us to kind of take a look at and something worth reflecting on together.
It certainly is.
Yeah.
It certainly is. But as you look at the various issues at hand, here in the United States, we embrace the gay person who is celibate. Mm-hmm. In Africa, some of the African countries, there's no such thing as embracing a gay person. So, those are really definite issues that they're going to have to take a look at and see, how is this going to be universal? It's a very difficult agenda.
Another key issue that the bishops are discussing is whether there could be any possibility for divorced and remarried people to take some sort of penitential path that would eventually allow them to receive the Eucharist. Yeah. And yet, again, something that's been brought up before, something that they are mulling over and trying to figure out. And there are a number of ways that can occur now, even, you know, with an annulment. And there's a number of things that we have in place in the church. Maybe it's streamlining that. We've seen the Holy Father do that with annulments just recently, right?
That's right. And I think we spoke about this maybe a year or so ago when we first started using some of the material for the synod. And we were talking about the development of the sacrament of penance in the second and third centuries and how the church has the wisdom to find a way to deal with these issues and so embrace people. So who knows? We may have an order of marriage that is altogether new and different, mm-hmm. dealing with these issues. It's exciting.
And interesting, yeah. I think that's such an important thing. In other Vatican news, Pope Francis has converted an old travel agency building into a new homeless shelter for men, just in time for the cold winter months. The new dormitory is called Gift of Mercy, because mercy is love's second name, Archbishop Konrad Kadrewski, the Apostolic Almoner, said.
Earlier this year, Pope Francis established showers, bathrooms, and a barbershop inside the Vatican to serve the homeless population. The new shelter, just around the corner from the Vatican, is furnished by the Papal Office of Charities and Donation and is run by sisters from Mother Teresa's Missionaries of Charity.
With enough space to house 34 men, the shelter brings the Vatican's total capacity for housing the homeless up to 84. Besides the Gift of Mercy House, the Missionaries of Charity also run the Gift of Mary Home in the Vatican, a homeless shelter for women established by Pope John Paul II and Mother Teresa in the late 1980s. You know, it's good to clarify this because I meet people, you know, all over who tell me, well, what are they doing? They think this is in St. Peter's Basilica. But the Vatican, you know, is a large collection. First of all, it's a state. And then secondly, it's a large collection of buildings. So, you know, that's part of what they're talking about here, is they're using these other buildings for these kinds of things, and buildings that might have been used for something else at one point are being converted.
Yeah, it's quite interesting that the Pope wants very clearly to do, in effect, what he talks about
Yeah.
You know, so he puts it into practice.
And it's a wonderful
right
thing.
There in the Vatican. Great
and,
stuff.
And even his discussion about taking in Syrian families and who are refugees, that's even extending. I heard of a parish in our own diocese where they're considering that right now. So, I mean, it's beautiful to see how it's going out and it's growing. And again, hopefully we do this throughout the world, right?
Witness.
Yeah, it's very important.
Very important.
In national news, Planned Parenthood Federation of America announced that its affiliates will no longer accept any reimbursements for fetal tissue donations. The change comes after a series of videos were released revealing the organization's role in the donation of fetal tissue from aborted babies for compensation. The group behind the videos, the Center for Medical Progress, argued that the amounts of compensation were illegal, but Planned Parenthood denied that claim, stating that the accusations were part of a discredited smear campaign.
Planned Parenthood clinics allegedly accepted illegal amounts of compensation for fetal tissue of aborted babies they donated to harvesters. Federal law allows for the donation of fetal tissue for reasonable compensation to cover the cost of shipping and handling, but not for valuable compensation.
Currently, two House committees are investigating the organization and its practices. The House Judiciary Committee last week held a hearing on the medical ethics at Planned Parenthood clinics. And, you know, in a sense, I feel that we have to stay on this one, too. This is something we really have to keep abreast of. Even the fact that we're talking about shipping and handling of human remains. You know, it's just, it's an insane thing. And it's just something that just reminds us how far we really have to go.
It's so difficult to say that, even.
Don't you think? Yeah.
You know, that they would assist a woman in an abortion and then take that baby and use it. And some of the things that we heard on those videos.
Yeah, it's incredible, right?
Unbelievable.
So we need to stay on top of that and continue to work with all the pro-life organizations and support them in any way we can so they can continue to keep the pressure on. Such an important thing. Okay, we're going to take a quick break. We have more EFL News right after this.
We care about our members and care about doing the best for them.
We look at everyone as an individual, one person at a time.
We are trying to get the best quality care to all of our members, and that starts with the individual member.
We enroll members one at a time. We sit and talk with members one at a time.
We all work to help people get insured that don't have insurance.
1 million people now have health care because Fidelis Care exists.
It makes you feel good inside that you're making a difference.
It means a lot to me to be able to work for a company that I can be proud of.
I work with great people, dedicated, hardworking, knowledgeable people.
I've been a nurse 30 years, and it's the best group of people I've ever worked with.
The mission is very simple. People deserve health care, and that's what we do.
We're in it for the right reasons.
It's just loving, helping people at the end of the day.
Welcome back to Everyday Faith Live. Emmy-winning filmmaker Martin Doblmeier and Journey Films have produced a new two-hour documentary called Chaplains that will air on PBS stations later this month. But for more information on Chaplains, I'm going to hand it over to Sister Mary Alice.
Well, thanks, Monsignor. Chaplains seeks to enlighten the general public about the role that American chaplains play in their various areas of work. The film shadows chaplains from various faiths. Let's take a look.
Chaplains, men and women who represent their own particular faith or religious tradition, but because they work mostly in public settings, are trained to be of comfort and support for everyone, religious or not. There have been chaplains on the battlefield for centuries. Today, the battlefield can be anywhere people face danger, darkness, or despair, or where people simply seek a spiritual voice in a time of need.
Nobody really needs the chaplain until you really need the chaplain.
What a chaplain does is leans in to the painful places.
I am a rabbi by faith, but I'm a chaplain by trade.
I can encourage her, I can call her, I can pray for her, but I can't fix it.
So really, as a chaplain, you're out there, you're with the soldiers, you're with the troops, wherever they are.
You're in such a competitive environment such as we are, you can be afraid to talk because you don't want to appear to be weak.
I think families tend often to be very angry with God.
We felt that there was like a wall in between the police department and the Muslim community.
So I am the pastor for approximately 7,000 people who make up the Senate side of Capitol Hill.
In many ways, they look like a social worker. They're helping people solve life's problems.
Pastor, social worker, counselor, bridge builder. Chaplaincy today is an emerging profession that struggles to define itself as it faces challenges on many fronts. But chaplains offer a window into how to view religion, faith, and spirituality in a religiously diverse America that values the separation of church and state, even though exactly what that means is not always clear.
Well, I can identify 17 years as the chaplain for the New York Jets. You know despair, you know losing, but you also are invited into people's lives in a very different place as a chaplain, you know, on the football field at practices. And I've married people and baptized their babies, football players, and brought them back to the life of faith. Every Saturday I'm with the Jets. I'll be with them this weekend. I hear confessions and celebrate Mass. It's a beautiful role, that role of chaplain, don't you think?
Yes, and I think of some of the chaplains that have come through the various programs here in our diocese, because our chaplains need to also have a degree in theology, which mm-hmm. is important. And the service that they offer is like none other.
Yeah, it's important.
And, you know, it's really, really important. So much so that our Catholic Health Services of Long Island will be celebrating Pastoral Care Week with a screening of chaplains on October 28th at the DeMatteis Center for Cardiac Research and Education, located in Greenville, New York. For more information, you can log on to our website, www.drvc.org.
Our movie pick this week is called Woodlawn, and it's a film based on an inspiring real-life story about love and unity in a school torn by racism and hate in the 1970s. Sister Mary Alice also has more information on that one, too.
Thanks, Monsignor. In 1973, in Birmingham, Alabama, the heart of nearly every player of the Woodlawn High School football team, including its coach, Tandy Geralds, showed their dedication, love, and unity in a school filled with racism and hate to see the rise of its first African-American superstar, Tony Nathan.
Just a reminder, it takes us back to, you know, Pope Francis speaking to that joint session of Congress, talking about Abraham Lincoln and Dorothy Day and Thomas Merton, but also Martin Luther King. You know, mm-hmm. we have a long way to go. It's still, the dream is still being realized.
It is, and sports can play such a role in it.
Yeah, it's important.
That's so evident from this, isn't it? And on all our sports teams throughout the country, with our little ones.
The movie's Woodlawn, so Google it and you can find out where you can see it. We're going to take a quick break. We have more EFL News right after this. Welcome back to Everyday Faith Live. Well, our Holy Father never stops, so we have a Vatican event to share with you. On Sunday, October 18th at 4 o'clock in the morning from St. Peter's Square, we have Mass presided over by Pope Francis with the canonization of the Blessed Vincenzo Grossi of the Mary Immaculate Conception, Ludovico Martin, and Maria Alazila Guerin. There'll be an encore presentation of the canonization Mass at 3:30 p.m.
Bishop William Murphy of the Diocese of Rockville Center recognized diocesan employees earlier this week with a ceremony thanking them for their dedication and service. Telecare had five honorees, including Monsignor Jim Blorn, Other telecare employees were Travis Williams, Antoinette Orlando, Rich Valentine, and Mike Lucini.
And congratulations to everybody. It was great to be with all of you. And it's just great to work with such a great team here.
It sure is.
Really good. It was a really great day. We also want to congratulate another person, Lisa Tangredi Beattie, who is one of our production team members. There she is. Her and her husband, Sean, had the birth of their little girl, Gina Grace, born Tuesday, October 13th, on her parents' third anniversary. So that's wonderful. It's a true family here at Telecare, as a lot of you know. And we want to congratulate also Joanne Beattie, one of our senior producers, who's the proud grandma of baby Gina Grace. And God bless you all. What a great week it's been for us.
To find out more about these stories and other breaking news, you can follow us on Twitter or send us your tweets at Telecare TV. You can also like us on Facebook at facebook.com/Telecare TV. And of course, you can visit our own website at telecaretv.org.
Well, thanks for being with us, everybody. For Sister Mary Alice, I'm Monsignor Jim Vlone. We'll see you here at the same time next week. From all of us at Telecare, remember, keep the everyday faith live. Have a great week, everybody, and God bless. Great to be part of a credit union that professes our Catholic faith.
I trust Oceanside Christopher because not only do they have, you know, the best interest for me as a member in mind, but just they're always people helping people.
I saw firsthand during Sandy how we took care of our members.
I was one of the flood victims, and at that time when it happened, I gave up hope.
We're very grateful that we have our faith in the church, and we also have our faith in the credit union.